Hello, this is NanoDano at devdungeon.com with the next lesson in this series of Python Cookbook tutorials. In this lesson, we're going to make a game. Personally, I really love game development. I originally learned how to program by teaching myself Cute Basic and writing video games. The joy of playing your own games and being able to make them better is a feedback loop of great fun. Even text-based games can be a lot of fun. These days, everyone loves their eye candy, but there are still some text-based RPGs called MUDs, or multi-user dungeons, that people play. The game we're going to make is called the Guessing Game. It will be a building block for larger games to come. The computer will choose a random number between 1 and 10, and the user will have 3 chances to guess it. The computer will tell the user whether their guess was too high or too low. Create a new Python file. Let's name it guessing_game. Let's start off by greeting the user. Print, "Welcome to the guessing game." So what do we want to do again? Let's write it out in comments in plain English in the code. Computer guesses a random number between 1 and 10. User guesses the number. Computer tells user whether guess was too high or too low. User has 3 guesses before losing the game. There. Now we have some place to start. Let's do one thing at a time. Let's generate the random number first. So far, we have seen a few functions that are built into Python. We saw print, input, and the type function. Python is a large collection of functions, and some are grouped into modules. One of the modules that comes with Python by default is the random module. The random module has a bunch of functions related to generating random numbers and shuffling lists and other things related to randomness. You can find the documentation for the random module on the python.org website. You can also browse and see what other modules are available there. We will be exploring many of them later. On the documentation page, we see a function called randint, and it returns a random integer. That looks exactly like what we need. It shows us that it takes 2 parameters, a and b. The random number generated will be greater or equal to a and less than or equal to b. So we basically give it a minimum and a maximum, and it will return a random number somewhere in that range. Let's go back to our program and type in what we saw. random.randint parentheses a comma b. Well, we know we want the number to be between 1 and 10, so let's plug in those values right now, because we don't really have an a and a b, but we have the real numbers we want to use. PyCharm is giving us a hint here with the red squiggles under the word random. Let's mouse over it and see what it says. Unresolved reference. We have to import the random module before we use it. Python does not load the module automatically because it would be a lot of unnecessary overhead in terms of memory and speed if Python had to load every module it had, even for the most simplest programs. Instead, it waits until you explicitly load a certain module before it goes through all the trouble of importing it. PyCharm helps us with this import. Move the cursor to the word random where the red squiggles are, and press Alt-Enter or click the light bulb, and it will pull up the suggested fixes. Choose Import This Name. Now you will see an import statement at the top of the file. Import random. That's all we need to do to tell Python to load the random module and make all the functions available to us. You might be wondering why we have to put the random dot in front of our call to the function randint. We have to do this in order to specify that the randint function comes from the random module. Without the dot, it would look for a function called randint in our Python script, but we haven't defined one. This is done to avoid name collision. For example, let's say we also wrote our own function named randint. We can still use our version by calling randint, and if we wanted to use the random module's version of randint, we would call it using random.randint. Without this mechanism, Python would get confused and not know which version of randint to call, ours or the one from the random module. This also means it's possible for other modules to also define their own randint function if they really wanted to. We want to store the random number to a variable, so in front of the call to random.randint, add correct underscore answer equals. To test it out, let's print out the correct answer and run the program a few times to make sure it's generating a random number. Yep, that looks good. Now what? Well, let's ask the user for their guess. We already know how to do that from the last lesson. User underscore guess equals input guess my number. Now we're going to introduce something new. It's a conditional statement, the if statement. If user underscore guess equals equals correct underscore answer. Can you guess what this does? It's going to compare the user's guess to the correct answer and see if they're equal. Two equal signs means check if these two things are equal to each other. One equal sign, as we have seen, is used to assign a value. Actually, we need to convert the user input from a string to an integer before we compare these values. On the line before the if statement, but after the input function, write user guess equals int user guess. This is going to overwrite the user guess variable with the integer value. From then on, we can use it as an integer instead of a string. So what do we want to do if this condition is true? If the user guess does equal the correct answer, we want to print out good guess and you are correct. Let's add those print statements now. First, add a colon at the end of the line with the if statement and press enter. Notice it indented the next line for you automatically. Anything that is indented will be run if the if condition is true. Print good guess and then print you are correct on the next line. Both of these print lines are indented at the same level underneath the if statement. This means that these lines will get executed if that condition is true. If this condition is not true, everything indented here will be skipped. Let's try it. Nothing happened. We must have guessed wrong, and therefore it did not run the code inside the if statement. It would be nice to let the user know if they guessed wrong, though. Instead of just saying, if this, then that, you can also say, if this, then that, otherwise, do this. That is called an else statement. We also have to indent the code that is associated with this condition. On a new line, after the if block, type else colon, indented all the way to the left. Press enter, and on the next line, indented one level, print incorrect. Let's try it now. That's better. We must have guessed wrong, and therefore the if condition was not true, so it fell through to the else statement and told us we were incorrect. So now we're getting the user input, and we're also giving the user feedback, but we were supposed to tell the user whether their guess was too high or too low. Our if statement already handles the case when the user is correct, but we also want to handle cases where it is lower or higher, and we want to handle them separately, instead of all the incorrect answers being directed to the generic else statement. There is another keyword we can use, and that is else if, and in Python that's written elif, E-L-I-F. Add elif user guess greater than correct answer, print, sorry, you guessed too high. Similarly, add elif user guess less than correct answer, sorry, guess too low. It's going to check these conditions in the order that we wrote them. As soon as the first condition is met, it will run the block of code associated with it and ignore the rest of the cases. If we're comparing these values to see if they're equal, and also checking whether they're greater than or less than, there's no reason for this last else statement. It'll never be reached. A number will always be equal to, greater than, or less than another number. So there's no reason for this last else statement anymore. Let's get rid of it. Great. So now we've written all the code to do almost all of the tasks for our game. It actually works already, but it only gives you one chance, and we wanted to give the user three chances. To do that, we'll need to keep track of how many guesses the user has. So at the top, let's create a variable called number of guesses and set it to 3. This will track how many guesses the user has left. Let's take a second to clean up this code. I don't like the way it's looking right now. I want to move a couple of the comments around and add some blank lines to separate and create readability. First, let's add a comment to the top where we're printing out the intro and initializing the number of guesses. Let's say game setup. Let's also add a blank line after the section of code that does the game setup for readability. Then let's take the comment from the bottom where it says user guesses number and move that up to where the actual code is that does that. Same thing with the comment about the computer giving a message back to the user. Also add a blank line between the user guessing and the response being output, just for readability, to separate those chunks of code. Let's move that last comment from the bottom and put it on the line where we define the initial number of guesses. There, this looks much better. After the user guesses, we'll want to subtract 1 from the number of guesses. After the big block of if statements, indent it all the way to the left, put number of guesses equals number of guesses minus 1. This will decrement or lower the value by 1. PyCharm is trying to give us a hint here with the squiggle. Let's see what it is. Assignment can be replaced with augmented assignment. What does that mean? Well, let's just click the light bulb and use its suggestion and replace it with an augmented assignment. Ah, this is a shorthand way of writing the same thing. Minus equal will decrement the value of a variable by 1. This is much closer, but we have to do one more thing. We have to repeat this whole guessing process until the number of guesses runs out. Create a new line above where we ask the user for their input. Add while space number of guesses greater than 0 : While is a special keyword that creates a loop. It will keep repeating a block of code over and over as long as the condition is true. In this case, keep repeating until the number of guesses is no longer greater than 0. So as soon as the number of guesses drops down to 0, the while loop will stop running. So how do we specify what code is supposed to get repeated over and over again? Just like we did with the if statement, we have to indent all of the code one level that is associated with the while statement. Highlight all of the code involved with the user guessing and being given a response. That whole block of input should be highlighted, and then press Tab to indent it one level. Now, everything indented here will get run in the loop. There's one problem here, though. If we guess the number right, the game does not end if there are still more turns. It'll keep on going if they still have extra turns left. We can go into the if statement where the person guesses correctly and use the break keyword. This will break out of the while loop. It's a special keyword that says, I don't care what the conditions are for this loop, I want to get out of it right now. It's not a function, so you don't put parentheses after it. We want to add the break after we print out that they guessed correctly. It would also be nice if it printed out whether the user won or lost at the very end of the program. So let's go down to the very bottom of the program, after the while loop, indent it all the way to the left, and add if user underscore won equals equals true with a capital T, : enter, and then print you win. Also add an else condition that says print you lose. True and false with capital letters are special values in Python. You may have noticed that we do not yet have a variable called user underscore one. So let's create one. At the beginning of the file, where we are generating our random number and getting the game set up, let's also create a variable called user underscore one and set it to false. So by default, the user is not winning and will not win. The only way the user can win is if they guess the number right. So let's go into the if statement where that happens, where we say you guessed correct. And before we break out, let's update the user one variable to be true. That's it, we're done. Give it a run and play it a few times. The last thing we want to do is commit our changes to the Git repo and push the changes to GitHub. Right-click on your root project folder in the project panel and go to Git commit directory. Check the box next to the guessinggame.py file if it's not already checked. Add a commit message saying, adding guessinggame. Mouse over the commit button and choose commit and push. Finalize the push, and you're all done. If you liked this video, please subscribe to the channel and share it with your friends. If you haven't watched the earlier videos in the series, I recommend you check those out too. Also, keep watching the next videos if you want to keep learning Python and building up your cookbook. Thanks for watching, and keep coding.